Well, you can be turning your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. If I could have the singers just for a moment. As I was studying this afternoon in prayer, we know every sermon doesn't go in the same direction. Amen? Trying to be led as best I can, I just felt that the Lord would have us to have an evangelistic service tonight. And I could be missing it, but I feel that I have the mind of the Lord. I gave him a song before I begin tonight, and I just want us to sing that if we can as before I begin. I'm going to need your help, though, to do this tonight. If we could all stand just for a moment. I want to make this a house of hope tonight. I want us to begin to pray just for a few moments as we sing this chorus, that a spirit of conviction would sweep over the audience that's here, resident, and those listening. How many know our nation needs hope today? Some of you have family members. Maybe you've brought them. Maybe they're not here. Pray for them as we sing this song. It talks about the river. And this is the case for everyone who needs the Lord tonight. We sing it to you. My heart's been heavy, my soul is dry, and now I'm desperate for the water. I've been so empty, just getting by, but now I'm desperate for the water. Oh, how I need the river. How I need the healing stream. Yes, I'm running to the river. Gonna let it wash on. Listen now, I'm tired of drinking. Is that your story? From bitter wells. Oh Lord, and now I'm desperate for the water. Too many deserts I've walked by myself. And now, Lord, I'm desperate for the water.
Over me.
Just one more time.
Hey, I need.
Jesus. Every hand outstretched, let's offer up a prayer. Father, we ask in the name of Jesus that, Lord, you would penetrate the darkness tonight, that you would touch every lost soul, everyone who needs hope, that they would find it in Jesus tonight. And Father, we ask it in the name that is above every name, that that river would flow, that river that flows from underneath the altar. Everything it touches, your word tells us, shall live. Everything it touches, no matter the darkness, no matter how tough a case, it's not too tough for you, it shall live and not die. We ask it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said tonight, amen. Amen. Come on, say it again. Amen. 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 You may be seated. Hallelujah. I love that song. If you have your Bibles, as I've said, I want to take my text for the next few moments as the Lord helps me from the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and starting in the 30th verse. I'm tackling the subject tonight of hope. I believe lives are being destroyed in our nation because the Christian influence is waning. Charles Spurgeon said, there won't be a baneful atmosphere, speaking of the church, not only our nation, of course I'm referring to even God's people, but there won't be a baneful atmosphere, he said, and you not feel it. And we're seeing people living in hopelessness tonight. But the title of my message tonight, I'll give it to you now, is Jesus Christ is our living hope. And I know this is what maybe you would refer to as a meat and potatoes message for some of you, but for some, it's going to be your first meal at the table. That's what I'm believing, that God would capture your heart, that you find hope tonight in Christ. Chapter 15, verse 30, the Bible says this, Paul speaking, and why stand we in jeopardy every hour? I protest by your rejoicing, which I have in Christ Jesus, our Lord, I die daily. Paul's essentially just asking this question. If there's no coming rapture of the church, if there's no resurrection, why do we go through what we go through? If we have no final resting place and there's no final hope, there's no purpose in traveling this road with Christ. Can I get an amen? But how many know that there is a blessed hope? And of course, the context, there were some individuals coming into the church at Corinth, and they were dissuading the people of God's minds from this great doctrine of the resurrection, and Paul's dealing with that here. But he says this, if after the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantage is it me if the dead rise not? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. If there's no hope, then as some secular artists have written in their songs, we can say it tonight as they herald it from the rooftops, nothing really matters. Let's eat, let's drink, for tomorrow we die. And Paul is trying to keep the Christian from losing his manner of life by including and by involving himself with relationships that are steeped in unbelief. It's not the cigarettes tonight, it's not the alcohol, it's not the drug addictions. That's not what Paul is saying will corrupt your manner of living. It's their unbelief that is most dangerous to you, and that's exactly what's happening in this context. The idea that there is no blessed hope, which is a foundational pillar of our faith, folks. It really is. Paul said in, or rather Peter said in the second, his second epistle, he said, in the last days, mockers will come saying, what are the signs of his coming? All things have continued as they are from the beginning. And with a last day church will come a last day heresy. And that heresy will involve and include the idea that there is no coming resurrection. And it is dangerous. It is harmful. That's why John the Apostle would tell us in the book of Revelation that there is a blessing attached to he who hears the words of this prophecy, speaking of the latter times, to he who keeps the words of this prophecy and to he who understands what he's reading, there's a blessing, and I don't want anyone to steal my blessing. It can speak of happiness, it can speak of increase, but I want you tonight, I want those listening to be prepared and understand that Satan's trying to steal our hope. And in some lives, in case of some, he's already done it and is trying to do and work his great work of discouragement, which comes when we have no hope. But this is what Paul said, be not deceived. Look at your neighbor tonight and say, be not deceived. Evil communications, listen, corrupt good manners. The friends you're keeping, the relationships you have, said it already, I'll say it again. They're destructive and they're evil. First of all, not just because of the manner of living, but because of their manner of unbelief. Your worst nightmare, your worst friend, or the lack thereof, is someone who's steeped in unbelief. And he goes on to say, awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. What Paul is clearly saying in chapter 15, verse 34 here, is that the true knowledge of God, listen, the knowledge that comes from above, that James talked about, that produces righteous fruit, that knowledge will never lead, when we encourage or when we incur the knowledge of God, it does not lead to a life of sin, to a life, rather the contrary, amen? The understanding of God's grace produces a life of holiness. True grace will teach us to deny ungodliness. Can I get an amen tonight? But when we throw off our faith, evil communication, corrupting our manners, corrupting our manner of living, some are there tonight because they have no hope. And I want to preach a message entitled, Jesus Christ, Our Living Hope. Pray with me and for me. Father, I thank you for your grace, and I thank you for these next few moments that we have to encourage and to preach and teach your word. And I would ask, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit, that your spirit of conviction would come into the house, Lord, that you would help me, Lord, to speak to those tonight who are wandering in sin. Lord, the time is short, and the door of the ark is going to close soon. And we ask, Lord God, that you would help us to reach from every parts of the globe somebody, Lord, who has no hope tonight. And I ask it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. I told Paris before I took the pulpit tonight, he'd appreciate this one. This morning, my wife told me this coming in. We were in the van coming, and she said, when Paris was giving the communion and leading us in the communion service, of course, my kids were out here this morning, and Jane was, I think she did a pretty good job. Amen. Jane did a great job in the national anthem, and I'm proud of her. But my kids were sitting out here watching it, and Paris was, you know, preaching hell, fire, and brimstone here for a moment and letting you know, warning, you know, don't take this cup or this bread if there's sin in your life. And Simon, my 4-year-old, he was standing by his mom, and all of a sudden, you know, and Simon has this unique way about him. He sticks his tongue out to the left of his mouth, and he pulled on mom's coat. Mom, I brought Wyatt's guitar. Spirit of conviction. It worked, Paris. Right before the communion service. And, you know, we might laugh, but when someone gets saved, they become like a child. And the simple message of it's time to turn around and it's time to lay down the sin in your life It's time to come home. That individual becomes like a child. And if we don't humble ourselves, Jesus said, like a child, we won't enter the kingdom of heaven. And I'm praying that that's exactly what will happen tonight. I was encouraged this week. How many are thankful for your spiritual heritage? Come on, you can talk to me tonight. I'm thankful for my spiritual heritage, and I try to do the best I can to learn and research. And I know that all of us have heard the name A.N. Trotter come up quite often. Obviously, it's on the building here, and one of the buildings named after him, that great preacher of the gospel that, again, Brother Swaggart had the privilege of preaching with. And I did my best to kind of listen to some of his sermons. I found some. Brother Larry Martin, he has, and I'll direct you to it, he has a great website called Pentecostal Gold, and he archived quite a few Pentecostal preachers and their messages. And on that website this week, I was able to listen to one of the sermons of A.N. Trotter, and the title of his sermon is peculiar, but I just want to start this way tonight. The title is Three Unusual Words. Three unusual words, but the great thing about that, and I'm not going to preach his whole sermon, but I will borrow from it. If it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? I'll borrow from it, and the three words tonight that were unusual, we don't hear them very often, especially in America, of course. There are three names, and the first is Ebenezer. Ebenezer, and he started off telling us how in New England, up in the Northeast, it's common to hear of a young man being named Ebenezer. Down here in the South, not so much. But Ebenezer, these three, beginning with this first one, these three names I'm going to say or state, they describe the Christian life. And this is the description he gave. Ebenezer, it is the place or the stone that was named Ebenezer by Samuel. Samuel had acted as judge in Israel and given Israel victory over the Philistines. And in doing so, he named the stone Ebenezer, and it means this: up to this point, the Lord has helped us. And all these, again, these names describe our experience as a Christian, the hope we have in Christ. Ebenezer, hitherto, the Lord has helped us. Do you remember when he helped you? Do you have a testimony today of something God has done? And there as a monument, not just a memory, but a memorial of what he did. We need to do that more often. We need to take the testimonies and remember and set up a memorial in our minds of the fact that hitherto God has helped us. I look to the past and he's helped us. The second name to fast track through his sermon was Emmanuel. Not a common name. I think I've only met one person named Emmanuel. But the Bible says in Matthew chapter 1 and verse 23, it tells us that he shall be called Emmanuel, God with us. God with us. I look back, God has helped us. I look around, God is with us. I'm going to say that again. I look back on my Christian experience, and I have to say I wouldn't be here if he hadn't helped me. Come on now. I'm talking about hope tonight. I look back and see the help he offered, the grace I didn't deserve that he gave me to walk through valleys and trials. And hitherto, he's my Ebenezer. He's given me help and strength along the journey, but he's also yours and mine, and the law couldn't give us this. As far on the ladder of the law you could climb, the prophet Jeremiah, Ezekiel couldn't give it to us, David couldn't bring us there, but when Jesus came, he was Emmanuel. He became the Lord. He became God with us, and I want to tell you tonight, he's still Emmanuel, God with us. He doesn't dwell in temples of stone. He doesn't dwell in temples and material things. He dwells in the spirit and soul of man. You're the temple of God, and where you go, he goes. He's been with me. He's helped me. Thank you. and he's with me. But in the 16th chapter of 1 Corinthians, our text, chapter 16 and verse 22, Paul says something striking. He said, those that do not love the Lord Jesus, anathema. That's not the word. And you're saying, thank God. Cursed be those who do not love the Lord Christ. You say, I thought God was a God of love. What do you mean cursed? There's a curse, and there it is. Upon every life that rejects the hope of the gospel. Are you here? A curse, meaning things won't get better. When you hear, have the opportunity to hear and reject, and especially those of you who've grown up in church, they reject and they rebel even harder and faster. And judgment can come even swifter, more swiftly. But it's Maranatha. You know what that means? The Lord comes. The Lord is coming. I look back, he's helped me. I look all around me, he's with me. I look ahead, he's coming. I said, I look back, he's been my strength, my help, my strength, my fortress, my deliverer. He's been my help. I look around me, he's with me no matter what. I'm justified and he's sanctifying me. Can I get an amen? And number three, as Paul teaches in this book, I look ahead. Come on now, church. I look ahead and he's coming. I get angry tonight when I look at the world around us. I can't help it. And when I just pondered this evening, it just angers me to think that my generation is listening and the world's message is louder and louder and louder. And they're buying it. And the church and our message, we are rescinding, we are detracting what we've once believed. And we're saying we need new things, but it angers me when I think about the reality of sin. It angers me when I think about the fact that my kids are gonna have to be educated as to what a man is and what a woman is. That makes me angry, upset. Because I know where it will lead. It will lead to a life of hopelessness. When we embrace sin, the confusion, the discontentedness, the depression, the loneliness. Have you stopped to consider that for some and for most, throwing off your faith will lead to these things? That's what Paul was saying. We don't sorrow as they sorrow. We don't sorrow as those who have no hope. And when we throw off the faith, and the gospel is the cross and the resurrection, it's all intertwined. You can't separate it. Amen? Paul didn't separate it. I'll prove it to you. Chapter 15, verses 12 through 19. Are you there? No, you're not. Let's get there. Listen to what he said. Now, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? What's he saying? He's saying this. If you don't believe in a coming resurrection, you can't believe in the first resurrection. Because if he didn't rise, he's not coming. But since he rose, then I have a message for you, church. I have a message for you, world. He's coming again. That's the blessed hope. But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? Says it again. And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is vain. Think about it. Your faith depends on the fact that the Hebrews writer says he ever lives. He oversees the distribution, the benefits of the covenant. And we are found false witnesses of God. Verse 16, for if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. You are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. And verse 19 says this, if in this life only we have hope in Christ. And this is where my heart is tonight for those of you. We are of all men most, say it with me, miserable. Misery, discontentedness, loneliness. I'm not happy. You know, a cross preaching, resurrection believing church should be the happiest church. I just proved it to you. So if you're not shouting, you know, you got a few seconds. We should be the happiest church. We should. Because to believe he's not coming, he says, you are of all men. If we only have hope in this life, if this is all there is, we are of all men most miserable. A person can live a lifetime without sex. It's true. Possibly 75 days without food. Maybe 10 days without water. 6 minutes without air. But it's entirely impossible, we're told by sociologists and people who study the mind, to live another second without hope. It's impossible. Among the great needs in our world today is hope, and many young people have lost hope. That's why many of them are rebelling, turning to drugs and other things. They look into the future, they see no hope. People talk about Armageddon and global genocide. One of the New York Times bestsellers, a philosopher once said, America needs a philosophy of hope and confidence. A former prime minister of Canada, he once said, billions of people are living today without hope. And he said, hope is the greatest need of our generation. Why? They tend to give up. They see no sense of responsibility. And many people, again, they're hiding from reality. When you have no hope, you have no sense of responsibility, and you're hiding from reality. Did you know, I listened to, it was either a podcast or some type of seminar, that between the ages of 20 and 40, young men my age are living in their basements, playing video games all day. They've not gone back to work. They've said, my life doesn't matter. Now, somebody said, well, 2 years ago, we said their job wasn't essential. So we'll just get the big cats to do your work and go home. I don't know if that has anything to do with it or not, but they have no hope. Suicide, I got an email from a police officer who was, he was in, It was training for his department. They have to go through it every other year or every year. And he sent me an email and gave me the statistics. This is staggering. But he said it went up about, in the year 2020 and 21, attempted suicide, now that's attempted, went up to 20 million in our nation. 20 million people. You want to talk, with this atmosphere of unbelief comes hopelessness. You can't live another day, another second, without the truth that he's coming. Singers, musicians, come on back. People are searching for hope. They're studying the zodiac signs. They're trying to use computers to predict the future. Because no one knows what's coming. Another well-known philosopher stated, the most widespread feeling of the day is one of hopelessness and helplessness. And what oxygen is to the lungs, such is hope to the meaning of life. That was stated by the evangelist Billy Graham. What oxygen is to the lungs, such is hope to the meaning of life. There was a church in Fort Myers, Florida. I say there is a church, Assemblies of God Church. Pastors, the staff, they met on every Monday. I think the pastor said in his message, he said 18 of them every Monday. They tried to scheme or, not scheme, wrong word, my fault. But they were trying to surmise, how can we reach the public? How can we bring people in? They came after, they figured out idea after. He said this, he said, I didn't hire y'all because I was smarter than you. I hired you because you were smarter than me. I need your help. If you weren't smarter than me, I wouldn't have hired you. He said, I'm the one who dreams, you're the one who does it. That's my job as a pastor. Here nor there, I'll say this. They were looking for different ideas, and some pastors, they came up with the idea they would go down to the nightclubs. Bad idea. Just saying. And he told them that. He said, let me tell you what's going to happen. You're going to go down to the nightclubs, and these were gentlemen, right? And there's crude dancing, and you all know the story there. You're going to go down to the nightclubs, and CNBC is going, is that what you call them, right? Is that the name of the CNBC? Is that still a broadcast, or they go out of business? Okay, all right. Well, fake news either way, but CNBC, one of those acronyms. They'd be down there, what is it? They're trying to help me. Oh, that's right, yeah, I'm blowing it. A newscaster is going to be standing there with his cameraman. Some homeless guy is going to be standing next to you, and he's going to be drunk, drunker than Cooter Brown. And he's going to say, hey, this is a cool place. And the Assemblies of God pastors brought me here. He said, you're not doing it. That's what the story on the news is going to be. But, everybody say, but. Some of the women of the church, they took the idea, and they started a nightclub outreach. But just the women would go. And every week they would pray before they went. They would pray. I'm talking about hope tonight. Somebody needs to hear that he still sees where you are. Somebody still needs to know there's hope for you. When the disciples were out on a raging sea, they thought they were alone, but you're not alone tonight. You're not alone tonight. He sees you where you are. Oh, yes, he does. He saw my dad in 1986 before my dad ever took one step in his direction. Thank God he saved his heart and life. But somebody needs to be reminded of hope tonight. And I just hope this does, no pun intended. I hope this does for you, remind you God sees you. They started to pray, and all the women of the church, they would enter that nightclub. And one of the evenings, the lady who had started headed up the thing, she walked into the nightclub, and I kid you not, she walked up onto the stage where these ladies were juking and jiving and pole dancing, and they were scantily clothed, and some of them not clothed at all. And she walked up to one of the young ladies, and she said, I have a gift for you, and I love you, and Jesus loves you. Listen. And the young lady who was, listen, she was miserable. These individuals, some of you tonight, you're miserable. Paul said, if you have only hope in this life, you're miserable. You don't understand, we try to blame our upbringing, but if we don't have the hope of the gospel, these vices, they will cling to us. And it's not just because of some wrong decision or something somebody else did. It's just simply because they don't see hope. Paul said it. He said, we'll just eat and drink and be merry, and we'll live however we want. There's no hope. And she collapsed to the ground. She collapsed to the ground, and she said, are you an angel? The lady said, no, I'm not an angel, but I am a messenger. But the young lady said this, she said, because I've never prayed before, but this afternoon I told whatever God there was up in the sky that tonight when I came home, I'm gonna kill myself. But that if he would send an angel my way, then maybe I'd believe he was real. And he's sending an angel your way tonight. And he's sending a message that says, if you only have hope in this life, you're of all men most miserable. But in Christ, our living hope, amen? He's alive, so you can live, so I can live. Oh, how I need the river. I want to sing that song one more time, all of you standing in this place. Think of these words. My heart's been desperate. My soul's been dry. And now I'm desperate for the water. Hallelujah. I've been so empty, just getting by. And now I'm desperate for the water. If you need a touch from him tonight, these altars are open. How I need, there's hope for you. The river. Oh, how I need the healing stream. Yes, I'm running to. Run to him. He loves you tonight. Run to him.
Gonna let it wash off.
I'm tired of drinking, Lord, from all the bitter wells. And now I'm desperate for the water. Too many deserts I've walked by myself. And Lord, now I'm desperate for the Lord, we thank you for the river. Hallelujah. I feel this comes out in preaching often, but I just want to say one simple thing to everyone listening. The relationships, the worldly ties, they're not worth it. And I like to say it this way. Whatever we've got to do to get there, do it. If it means separation from worldly relationships, do it. Whatever it is holding you back, there is nothing worth risking your relationship with God over. And tonight I want to pray with all those who've come, those listening over Sunlight Broadcasting. How many know and remember there's hope tonight? There's hope for you. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, to every life that's been crushed, to every faith that's been shaken, some shipwrecked tonight, Lord God, you are the creator. Lord, you are he who laid the foundations of the earth and stretched the heavens wide. You put man's spirit within him, Zechariah said. And you who created and formed man out of nothing. Lord God, I ask you to breathe life into the faith that once was. I ask that you would breathe, Holy Spirit, breathe. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come and rest on your people here tonight. Let there be faith arising. Let there be hope arising. Let there be truth arising in your people tonight. And let those who are lost be found. Let the light shine into the dark place. Let the orphan find their father, Lord God. Be a father to the fatherless. and give hope to those whose spirit is crushed. For you're near the brokenhearted, Lord God. And we ask it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Everybody said it. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. How I need the river. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise.